How I wish I could time travel to 1960s England. The music, the hairdos, the innocence of simpler days. Oh, and I hear that the quantum physics scene was pretty hip and happening too. Well, I only know about that because I'm making this video. See, having been a longtime fan of Jiddu Krishnamurti, I've been exposed to the many people who joined him in roundtable discussions. And I always wanted to learn more about the humble genius, the softly spoken gentleman frequently found by his side. Claimed by Einstein as his spiritual son and doted on by the Dalai Lama, this man's contributions to the world of science took the height of human thinking at the time to places it had never been before. In today's Masters episode, we're having coffee with American theoretical physicist, David Bohm. Hi everyone, welcome back to Vedic Life Coaching. Thank you so much for joining me and welcome back to the Masters series. Today we're having coffee with David Bohm, and this is my mushroom tea because that's what I want to have. I was just thinking, would David Bohm have coffee or tea? It's a really interesting question because he was an American, and Americans prefer coffee. The English prefer tea. He spent a large amount of his time in England. Actually, I think it was England where it all happened for him, as you're going to see as we go through his life. So yeah, in my research, I didn't come across which of the two he might prefer. But anyway, what I have done is I've gone through his life. I've written my notes on my Kindle, which I'll talk you through. And as always, I'm going to have charts by my side, which I'll light up in different places so that you can see the different elements I'm talking about as I speak about them. The other thing I'm going to do is somewhere, I'm going to leave a link above or somewhere to Jiddu Krishnamurti. He was the master that I covered last time. And I'm covering David Bohm this time. David Bohm had to follow after Jiddu Krishnamurti, absolutely had to. They are a bit of a double act in the realms of philosophy and science. And you'll also see that as we go through the notes here. So why don't we get stuck in? I couldn't actually find a time for David Bohm. So what I do in that instance is I take the birth details. I was able to find the year, date, location, everything. I was able to find everything except for the time. So now when that happens, what I do is I put it in my system and I look at the person from 12 midday and I look at them from the moon and I get a feel for that moon chart. As I'm studying that and as I'm studying the life, I'm able to see, I know, you know, I get a rough idea. And what I've done in this instance is I have rectified the time to 5 p.m., which I believe works in line with how life manifested around him. I used the D6 chart and I checked the times of 4:50 p.m. to 5:30 p.m. Now I use the D6 chart because that deals with illness and enemies, and I'll talk about that towards the end. If he were a real client in real time, I would refine further using some combination of D9, D10, and D60. D60 will enable me to get your time to 2.5 minutes. So if you were a client of mine, I wouldn't rectify you to 5 p.m. I'd be looking at 5:02, 5:01, you know, 4:59. I explore in very granular detail. But for the purposes of this video, I'm very happy to use just a rough time of 5 p.m. So let's work with this 5 p.m. chart, which is fairly stable and I believe fits the life quite nicely. David Bohm's childhood was tough. His dad was strict, and I get the impression money was very tight during those early years. To me, the 5 p.m. chart makes sense because it places Saturn in his second house. Plus, when you look at the Dasha system, it makes sense that his childhood took place during Saturn Mahadasha. This often indicates a tough childhood and makes a young child mature very quickly. When you interview these people during adulthood and you ask about their childhood, they are sometimes reluctant to say that anything was tough back then. Mars in David Bohm's fourth house works perfectly too. Some years into his journey through academia, he became the subject of a federal investigation in 1949 when Mercury Rahudasha became active. It meant he had to leave the United States for good. He tried to pursue his career in several countries before accepting British citizenship around the time of his Ketu Mahadasha. It was during this Mahadasha that Bohm met Vijaydeo Krishnamurthy, forming an enduring intellectual partnership that finally brought two of Jupiter's great domains together, the great wisdom of both the ninth and 12th houses. All of this was preparing Bohm to take up a full professorship at London's Birkbeck College in 1961. Perfect timing for his Venus Mahadasha, which was to become active just 2 years later. It was during this Mahadasha that Bohm created the theories and work of his life, implicate and explicate order. Now, I'm no scientist, but I can see his work come to life in this birth chart, the 5pm one. His theories examined the dependence and independence of different elements. That's the eighth house, right? Dependence is there. I always say that. He also created a hidden variable theory. Eighth house and 12th house deals with that which is hidden. When you trace all the lords involved from the position of Venus, we can see how Bohm's career really sprang to life at this time. We can see Saturn giving him the endurance to keep going over a long period of time. When it came to thinking, David Bohm was a marathon runner, not a sprinter. We can see Jupiter's ability to harness both academic concepts and those which lie beyond the veil. We can see how a partnership with an academic father figure type of person, like Krishnamurthy, would feed into and even inspire the unique and radical work he was doing. Father figure, son, unique and radical, Rahu. As for the D6 chart that I mentioned earlier, this is an interesting technique that I've never really tried before, but I'll share it anyway as I like to pull out unique things in each master's video. So the learning principle here is that the D6 chart represents enemies and illness. In the D6 chart, I have here for the time of 5pm, his sixth lord is in the fifth house. So via the Bhavat Bhavam principle, we can say that this person will have a loss of enemies. This is what happened in Bohm's life. It was basically Oppenheimer who kicked Bohm out of the United States. Now, Oppenheimer, I'm pretty sure, was the guy who was behind the atomic bomb. And I think he was Bohm's research professor in those early years of academia when Bohm was in the United States. And it was really Oppenheimer who wanted Bohm out. I checked his chart too. It was quite interesting, but that's maybe another video. Now, this was an event that matches Mars in the fourth house of Bohm's birth chart, right? So you've got that Mars in the fourth house there. Because Bohm didn't resist, and because he went with the flow of what was unfolding in the D1 chart, he was later able to experience a life without enemies. His future work was well received, and his epic partnership with Krishnamurthy will continue to inspire people who believe science and spirituality aren't domains in opposition, but that are in fact able to work together to help us all conquer new frontiers. So I hope you enjoyed my very brief overview of David Bohm. If you missed Jiddu Krishnamurthy and you'd like to see him, there'll be a link above so you'll be able to check that out. But I want to thank you so much for watching, and I look forward to seeing you next time.